On the night of November 11th, 1940, Swordfish dive and torpedo bombers from the aircraft carrier HMS Illustrious struck the Italian Navy in port at Taranto. In a devastating two-hour attack, the biplanes inflicted more than twice as much damage on its opponents as the entire British Grand Fleet had at Jutland a generation before. When Italy entered the war on Germany's side in June 1940, its navy immediately became a mortal threat to the Royal Navy's position in the Mediterranean. With France out of the war, Admiral Andrew Cunningham could muster just four battleships to the Italians' six, and only the aging aircraft carrier HMS Eagle to provide naval air support. This meant Cunningham's ships were stretched badly, trying to ensure supply convoys got through to isolated Malta, whilst looking over their shoulders at a dangerous Italian fleet. The balance of power only began to improve in early September, when the battleship Valiant and brand new aircraft carrier Illustrious arrived. Emboldened by his reinforcements, Cunningham was keen to seek a major fleet battle, but the Italians declined to be drawn into a decisive engagement. So long as their opponents remained unsunk, the British were forced to always operate as one fleet, unable to do two things at once for fear that the Italians would defeat them in detail. As autumn set in and an Allied offensive in Africa loomed, it was clear that something would have to be done to return the control of the sea to the Royal Navy, and if the Italians wouldn't fight at sea, then they would have to be attacked in port at Taranto. Surface ships couldn't hope to get close to the harbour, but the arrival of Illustrious opened up the possibility of an aerial attack. The premise of such a raid was simple. Both Eagle and Illustrious would steam close to the Italian coast under the cover of darkness, and launch a raid using their Fairy Swordfish, a remarkably versatile but chronically obsolete biplane that was the workhorse of the Fleet Air Arm. Designed in 1933 to perform a huge variety of tasks, at Taranto it was to be employed as a torpedo and dive bomber, with one of the three crew replaced by a long-range fuel tank. With a cruising speed of only 100 knots compared to the bombers in service with many other navies, the Swordfish was pretty obsolete. However, its unusually low airspeed resulted in an incredibly low stalling speed of just 55 knots. This meant pilots could perform all kinds of ridiculous maneuvers and stay in the air safely, as well as landing and taking off with little or no wind. The Swordfish was also a very sturdy aircraft, capable of taking a lot of punishment and surviving, and because of its basic construction, it could be repaired on board ship extremely quickly. All of these features would prove really valuable for the raid on Taranto. Initially, the attack was set for October 21st, the anniversary of the Battle of Trafalgar, but this date had to be pushed back after a dangerous fire broke out in Illustrious's hangar. To make matters worse, Eagle's fuel system completely broke down with just a few weeks to go, meaning she could play no part in the raid. Despite this, the attack was to go ahead regardless, even with half the available Swordfish strength. It was now set for the night of November the 11th. Surprise for the attack was paramount, and so when Illustrious left port along with the rest of the Mediterranean fleet on November 6th, her presence was publicly to help escort a convoy on its way to Malta. As the sun set on November 10th, she was secretly detached from the fleet and sped northeast, to a flying off position 170 miles southeast of Taranto. On board, her aircrew had their final briefings. The attack would be made in two waves of 12 and 9 Swordfish, respectively. Illustrious's 16 available aircraft were reinforced by 5 which had been moved over from Eagle. The origin ship of each machine can be worked out from the prefix letter in each aircraft's number, E for Eagle or L for Illustrious. The first wave would attack from the west, followed an hour later by the second from the north. Both would have 2 flare-dropping aircraft, with the task of illuminating the harbour for the raid. Following them would be a mix of torpedo and bomb-carrying Swordfish, who would need to evade barrage balloons and a huge amount of anti-air fire to attack the big capital ships located in the outer harbour. In a stroke of good luck for the British, earlier in the day the Italians had readied their fleet to sail and had failed to replace the anti-torpedo nets after their orders were cancelled. This left their battleships extremely vulnerable to torpedo attack. A little after 8:30 PM, the first Swordfish, flown by Lieutenant Commander Kenneth Williamson, got the green light and tore off into the night. One by one, the rest of the aircraft followed him, but as the last machine moved on deck, it caught the wingtip of Lieutenant Clifford's aircraft, breaking several of the wooden struts in the wing. Taken back into the hangar, the Swordfish was rapidly repaired within 30 minutes, and Clifford and his observer, Lieutenant Going, took off, determined to join the attack even if it meant doing so alone. Up ahead, by the time Clifford got going, the first wave was closing in on Taranto. At 4 minutes to 11, they split up, lining up for runs against their assigned targets. The wave's lead flare dropper, Lieutenant Kagel, swung into action, his first flares lighting up just as the torpedo swordfish streaked into the harbour at almost wave height. The air was at once filled with a huge amount of fire, but most of it was aimed at the flares, and the attacking British were flying so close to the sea that the Italians risked raking the decks of their own ships if they tried to hit them. Kenneth Williamson was one of the first in, wheeling around over the destroyers Lampo and Fulmine to drop a torpedo towards the battleship Conti de Cavour, with Sub-Lieutenant McCauley approaching from the opposite side with the same idea. His compatriot's torpedo missed, but Williamson's found its mark, gouging a huge hole in the side of the ship. As he pulled up to make his getaway, his swordfish was hit several times and crashed into the harbour. Both Williamson and his observer, Lieutenant Norman Scarlett, survived to be made prisoners of war. Shortly afterwards, it was the Littorio's turn to be targeted, as Lieutenants Kemp and Swain both scored hits on her with torpedoes in quick succession. Swain dropped his torpedo so close to the battleship that when he pulled up, the aircraft just barely made it over Littorio's masts. Lieutenant Maund, in the last torpedo swordfish of the first wave, had less luck, lining up on Vittorio Veneto only for the torpedo to run aground short of the target. The swordfish dropping bombs too were unlucky. Lieutenant Murray arrived at 11:05, descended and hit the destroyer Le Vecchio, but the bombs did not explode. Sub-Lieutenant Sarah could not make out any clear target, so opted instead to bomb the seaplane base, while Sub-Lieutenant Ford couldn't see any explosions after dropping his payload. The last aircraft to strike was piloted by Lieutenant Charles Lamb. Lamb was the assistant flare dropper and had held off so far as he felt the area was rather well illuminated already. Having skirted around the harbour, he dropped his bombs on oil storage tanks before making for home, dropping a bunch of flares as he did so to further confuse the Italian gunners. Not long after Lamb's departure, the second wave arrived. Its strength was down to 7 aircraft, with Clifford still trying to catch up, and another swordfish having to turn back to Illustrious after its long-range fuel tank fell off. The second wave's flare droppers detached at 5 to midnight and dropped their patterns of flares at about the same time, before turning to drop more bombs on the oil storage depot. This left 5 aircraft in the attack wave, which dived from the northwest to line up on the battleships. The wave leader, Lieutenant Commander Hale, lined up on Littorio alongside Lieutenant Torrin Spence and Lieutenant Bailey. As they approached, Bailey's swordfish suddenly jerked across the other's path and exploded into a ball of flame. Neither Bailey nor his observer, H.J. Slaughter, would survive the crash. Hale and Torrin Spence pressed on, both dropping their torpedoes, of which one would hit the Littorio, though it's not clear whose exactly this was. Behind these two came Lieutenant Lee, who headed straight for Cairo Duilio and hit her from 800 yards. To make his escape, Lee guided his machine at almost wave height between the cruisers Zara and Fiume. Finally, from over the town of Taranto itself came Lieutenant Wellham, whose swordfish was hit and damaged as he tried to make his approach towards the flagship Vittorio Veneto. Struggling to keep control, Wellham launched his torpedo but missed, as the Veneto continued to live a charmed life. This was the end of the second attack wave and left just one aircraft to arrive, Clifford and Going. They arrived after all the other swordfish had left and began an attack run on the cruiser Trento all by themselves, facing the undivided attention of the Italian anti-air fire. Managing to drop their bombs over the ship, the two air crew could only watch as they went clean through Trento without exploding. Of the 20 swordfish that took part in the raid, only 2 were lost. It was a miraculously low casualty rate, but the crews did not yet know how successful their raid had been. In the coming days, it would become clear. 3 Italian battleships were sunk on the harbour floor. Littorio and Cairo Duilio would take months to repair, while Conte di Cavour would never see active service again. 3 cruisers and 2 destroyers had also been damaged, and the seaplane base and oil storage depot thoroughly wrecked. In 2 hours, a handful of obsolete biplanes had crippled the Italian fleet and given Admiral Cunningham short-term naval superiority in the Eastern Mediterranean. It would now be much easier for the Navy to ensure Malta, Greece, and the Allied Army in North Africa remained supplied. It was an incredible achievement, one made by the bravery of men prepared to fly into a storm of gunfire with nothing but fabric and wood for protection. Thank you to War Thunder for sponsoring this video. War Thunder is a realistic, free-to-play vehicle combat game that allows you to join battle with millions of players across the world, in giant combined arms battles on PC, PS4 and Xbox One. It features over 1,200 historically accurate tanks, aircraft, helicopters and ships from the 1930s to the 1990s. This includes the Mark I Swordfish, the aircraft that played such an instrumental role at the Battle of Taranto. Using my link in the description below, you can join us on the battlefield and receive a free tank or aircraft as well as 3 days of premium time, so it's a great time to sign up. Thanks again to War Thunder for sponsoring this video. And as always, a big thank you is due to my patrons, without whom I simply wouldn't be here making YouTube videos at all. Thank you all very much for watching, and I will see you next time.